Hello, my name is Chris Smith. I'm very happy to be here, and my presentation today maps the complex terrain by which a rapprochement between hierarchized arts canons and vernacular aesthetics and values might be accomplished within the context of the university music ensemble. I explore a specific project which confronted issues of privilege, Orientalism, and 20th century arts politics, that is, the 2015 construction of an original, semi-improvised orchestral score for the 1922 silent horror classic Nosferatu, which is itself a particularly influential but highly charged film and saturated with anti-Semitism. Our new semi-improvised score, performed by conservatory students led by the composer instructors, sought to directly confront the othering embedded within Bram Stoker's original story, specifically by combining Western European orchestral and Eastern European instruments and music language in such a fashion that the cultural hierarchies implicit in the visual imagery were problematized and made explicit in the sound. Knowing the film's problematic casting, frame, narrative, and racial political stances, as teachers, we sought to center both the creative and the ethical issues raised as part of the pedagogical experience which we share with our young musicians. As we worked, we emphasized involving the students not just as musical cogs in a machine producing an orchestral performance, but also as active critical respondents who could be permitted their own agency to shape the resulting music. So my paper describes compositional and improvisational processes. It articulates the philosophical, political, and aesthetic goals which shaped those processes, and it seeks to unpack both the pedagogical and the political possibilities of such collaborative, practice-based learning experiences. In October of 2015, my Vernacular Music Center colleague Roger Landis and I were commissioned by the Flatland Film Festival of Lubbock, Texas, to construct a new live orchestral score for the 1922 vampire classic Nosferatu. Recognizing both the film's enormous influence and cinematic history, and also some of the exceptionally problematic connotations of its narrative and characterizations, we knew we wished our new music to challenge rather than reinscribe those stances. We were aware that we needed to educate the students to the film's text, historical context, and semiotic subtexts, and the issues that these raise for us almost 100 years later. So, we developed methods to demonstrate and then collaborate within the process of recontextualizing the film in order to create a more nuanced and challenging arts experiences for audiences and students. Rather than simply handing the ensemble their scores to be played at the same time as this historic visual artifact, our group mode of interaction with the film's texts was thus one of conversation, inquiry, and critique. In performance, our improvisatory process involved ensemble members and the audience themselves in that same mode. Nosferatu is widely recognized by film historians as a watershed moment in both technical and conceptual approaches to film narrative. Its author and director, F.W. Murnau, is seen as a significant innovator, particularly in the realm of experimental and expressionist movie making. At his moment in film history, there was still a window of opportunity for narrative cinema to be understood as an experimental form, and Murnau's method included a number of technical breakthroughs, including film compositing, reverse polarization, the use of varied film speeds, and the widespread use of on-location shooting. But at the same time, the project implicated violations of both intellectual property rights and endemic anti-Semitism and Orientalism. Murnau neglected any address to copyright issues and was thus sued shortly after the film's release by the widow of Bram Stoker, upon whose Dracula the film is transparently based. Frau Stoker was successful. German courts found for the plaintiff and the film was ordered destroyed. By chance, two copies survived, and in 2006, a complete reconstruction with extensive restoration and the addition of some previously unfound footage was released on DVD. However, the film's original date and Murnau's improvised procedures ensured that the more customary ephemera and background materials simply did not exist. For example, the script ran just barely 8 pages, and so it was really only a synopsis rather than any kind of shooting script. And so my colleague, Roger Landis, actually reverse-engineered a 52-page shooting script, cue by cue. As we worked with that reconstruction, and from it began to develop an understanding of the film's deeper structure, we identified about a dozen separate characters, tropes, and situations that seemed to require individual thematic musical material. In turn, this began to provide a sense of the narratives and the music's programmatic shape. Now, central to the critique we wished not only to articulate, but also to embody, was our desire that the racist and hegemonic semiotics implicit in the film's visual imagery should be problematized, and they should be made explicit through our reimagination of the score itself. In the fashion of editorial cartoonists like William Cruikshank, George Grosch, Thomas Nast, or more recently Robert Crumb, we sought out the anti-Semitism and racial fear that rumbled just beneath the surface of Murnau's original silent images, and we brought them forward into explicit and intensified conflict with the surface tale's conventional heroic apotheosis. Now, it's important to remember that the racism in Stoker's novel and in Murnau's film is neither coincidence nor merely a part of late Victorian racist expressive culture, but a quite conscious and intentional evocation of anti-Semitic signs. Stoker himself, for example, claimed to have based his conception of Dracula on his admired friend Sir Henry Irving's portrayal of Shylock from The Merchant of Venice. This intentionality is confirmed, for example, not only in terms of visual echoes, but also by semantic ones. In the two properties, the villain is named, respectively, Shylock and Orlock. That semiotic rhyme is not accidental, but intentional, and it's reinforced throughout the racist subtexts of the film, which our score sought to both foreground and contest directly via bicultural musical means. In 1921, the thematic presumptions of film music as non-diegetic but proscriptive connotative reinforcement were about a decade away, and thus Hans Erdmann's original live performance score, which was lost but subsequently reconstructed and completed, does not yet employ anything like the quasi-Wagnerian leitmotif which has dominated narrative film score storytelling down to Lord of the Rings and the Star Wars universe. However, recognizing the ubiquity of that theme-driven approach and of its efficacy with a 21st century audience whose entire experience of film scores has been shaped by it, we sought in our Nosferatu score to exploit leitmotif as a musical narratological technique, but to turn its hegemonic and historical conventions on their head. We wish to draw upon our knowledge of various Balkan vernacular music traditions in a fashion that radically dismantled the exoticism, cultural tourism, or banal pastiche with which Hollywood music has most typically portrayed the sonic other. Voglio cantare chicca chicca boom chicca, uma canção do chicca chicca boom chicca. Meu coração faz chicca chicca boom chicca e vem a saudade da Bahia. We know, in ways that Murnau and certainly Erdmann self-evidently did not, about the complexity, sophistication, and logical systems of Balkan music. So our reincorporation of more accurate regional elements in the score is a way to provide a voice to the place in which the film was set and shot, an approach rooted in actual musical practice and experience in communities, as opposed to the Erdmann score, and for that matter, Stoker's story itself, in which the Balkans are essentially silenced. And in fact, not only the thematic rhythmic characteristics of some of the more Balkan-inspired cues, but also the way that they're orchestrated. For example, the massive, powerful ascending brass chords in Carpathians are literally scored-in empowerments, which seek to build dramatic potency into cues which in other eras of film scoring might have been shaped for silence or twee exoticism. Thank you. partnered working method was thus both independent and also collaborative, apportioning different tropes and characters to one another of us, sketching themes, trading those themes back and forth for revision and discussion. Roger's expertise as performer and ensemble director in Balkan musics was especially useful. My familiarity with digital orchestration was likewise helpful. We continued in this fashion for several months, sending each other scores and MIDI sound clips, fleshing out the orchestration of the individual cues until we were ready to start rehearsing. For context, we work for a large music conservatory enrolling approximately 680 students, which itself is housed within a very large Tier 1 research university of about 40,000 students. So in addition to the full complement of university music ensembles, bands, choirs, orchestra, jazz, and chamber groups, we also maintain an early music ensemble, a Celtic ensemble, and a Balkan ensemble. Although the Nosferatu Orchestra itself was an ad hoc collective, our participating students came from across a wide diversity of prior ensemble experiences and priorities, though none had ever played for a film before, and there was very little experience in improvisation. Obviously, the experience of students already operating from the Balkan ensemble was useful in this context, and I'll have more to say about that. Our rehearsals thus began with an orientation for our student ensemble members, which both addressed practical matters of instrumentation, schedule, and performance practice, but also spoke of the film's historical context, significance, innovations, and its subtexts. Viewing extended excerpts in silence, we thus shared with the students from the beginning of the collaborative process our desire to directly confront in sound the film's difficult and troubling images. As one of us put it in that first orientation, we're going to go right at it. At the same time, we also knew that we did not want to treat our developing artists as cogs in an ensemble machine, the way that most film orchestras, and for that matter, most student ensembles are treated. We wished instead for these collaborators to contribute to the dialogue around the film, both in conversation outside of performance and, importantly, via the agency of collaborative choice within performance. We consciously chose, therefore, to work with a small number of themes, that is 12 plus a prelude, and for both practical and philosophical reasons, to eschew the conventional through-composed, time-coded scoring approach. Instead, we opted to combine two extemporaneous techniques. First, though cues were assigned to passages within the film and their approximate narrative sequence, related to characters, inciting incidents, key conflicts, and so forth, those cues could also be layered or combined on the fly, especially as characters, incidents, and conflicts recurred and heightened over the course of the narrative. Secondly, we wanted to train our student musicians to enter the very unfamiliar space for them of live cues and conducted improvisations. So in the beginning, we created a set of 12 very large cardboard-backed orchestrated passages of the score, which could be called for, juxtaposed, or reorganized on the fly with the assistance of a conductor's assistant. Similarly, and here we did borrow from standard orchestral practice, in each stand, partner number two would prepare the upcoming part, while partner number one was playing the current cue. After the first performances in 2015 and 16, we refined this process and arrived at a semi-memorized sequence of themes, which could be contained within a conductor's score or player's folder of music, but which still served primarily as jumping-off points for section and group improvisation. As we further refined a road version of the score, through the necessity of adapting to restricted forces and student players' varying experience, we developed a closer kinship to iconic expressionist chamber orchestral theatrical works like Pierrot Lunaire of 1913 and L'Histoire du Soldat of 1918. As with those works, ours was scored one to a part, with extensive doubling on multiple instruments, precisely because Nosferatu's experimental nature and financially straitened premieres had demanded similar ingenuity and creative problem-solving as had those earlier iconic stage pieces. So we worked with individual cues in and out of sequence, subsequently incorporating excerpts of the film for each cue, and then playing through each again after seeing those images. We practiced on-the-fly selection, cueing, recombination, and improvisation. As with so many premieres, there were challenges in terms of preparation time and learning curve. As might be expected, with revision and additional performances, the score breathed more. Though, as so often with student ensembles, changes in availability also necessitated the inevitable incorporation of new players and ever-evolving procedures. Now, it should be recalled as I describe this process that as pedagogues, creative thinkers, and creative artists, we critique not only art objects or cultural biases from the past, but also our own present-day and hence implicitly classist, gendered, racist, or otherwise biased cultural programming. Anytime we make an art object, particularly one which centralizes not only our creative conversations with one another, with students, and with audiences, but also literally our conversation with the past, and with Murnau, and with his time period, with the film, and our musical responses topic, we are called upon to investigate the biases implicit both in the art object and in our own age and culture. We must interrogate our own cultural programming, demonstrating to and sharing with our students the reality of its existence. And we must make critical inquiry and self-reflection about race, class, gender, and other biases, part of our collaborative artistic process. Every film composer asks, does this cue convey what I want, or is it subject to misinterpretation? We, however, seek to add a particular layer of cultural interrogation to this pragmatic critique. And so we ask not only what does this convey, how does it do that, but also what are its implications? How can we interrogate and subvert our own hegemonic entitlement? How do we give voices back to the voiceless or the silenced? We might begin perhaps with the very active involving students in the conversations about why we are proceeding with these techniques by articulating clearly and openly as part of artistic collaboration. We can push back against the cog in a machine industrial factory hierarchical model by expecting and inviting young musicians to have ideas and make spontaneous contributions, believing that even as developing artists or novice improvisers, they are capable of unique and thus valuable improvisational choices. As an example, in the rehearsals just prior to the premiere, we had shared with the student musicians the film's various implications of plague, contagion, infection, and sickness, which Murnau employed to reference the threat of the Semitic East. And then at the premiere, one percussionist, an avowed fan of classic cinema, and as it happens, the only one of the musicians who'd made a point of viewing the entire film prior to the first rehearsal, improvised a slow, low B timpani rhythm that evoked a fevered heart. As conductor, I recognized immediately the aptness and the semiotic power of this low, irregular timpani beat, conducted by Stephanie in its application, and led her through the balance of the improvised premiere performance, and then I reverse-engineered that now crucial, originally improvised timpani part into the score. This is an example of our practice of seeking a film score live performance procedure, which is more like the improvisational interaction of vernacular music itself, that is, a kind of vernacular film music, one that more accurately reflects the beauty, complexity, sophistication, and individual artistic agency of vernacular music, and which employs those characteristics precisely to dismantle the racist hegemony of Nosferatu and of Hollywood film music itself. As teachers of artistic practice, we engage the hegemonic conventions and semiotic presumptions of film score narrative via the use of decentralized and radically democratized vernacular processes of improvisation, spontaneous recomposition, player agency, and so forth. Now, it should be noted that despite the copyright challenges that such a process inevitably confronts when dealing with a work which, unlike Nosferatu, is not in the public domain, and which copyright challenges themselves reflect a centralized and hegemonic structure of intellectual enclosure, these kinds of vernacular mashups can present very specific possibilities for interrogating political and artistic privilege. We can, thus, seek directly through a new piece of sound art to promote conversation about cultural hegemonies. In the conservatory, which literally exists for the central purpose of conserving not only a canon of great works, but also a set of canonic procedures and an attendant set of values, those cultural hegemonies manifest across a wide range of procedures and processes, in composing, in rehearsing, notating, improvising, in player and audience contributions, and so forth. It's not an accident that the Modern Symphony Orchestra, and shortly thereafter the Modern Conservatory, developed in roughly the same period that the enclosure of public commons, public knowledge, and indeed of workers' wage hours was reducing individual agency and was demanding standardized machine-like responses from individual workers to the forces of both material and artistic production. Even those musical forms which began as vernacular outside the academy are changed in content and meaning when they enter the new contexts and political climates of the conservatory. Recognizing this centralizing, standardizing, and hierarchizing impulse in the structures of academic music institutions, we evoke Occupy Wall Street's model of radical democratization of communicative and creative processes. In addition, as university educators, we face another very great challenge. We have an ethical obligation to our students to engage with these structures rather than merely, however satisfyingly, tearing them down. Precisely because many of our students must be certified as educators and likewise therefore need to learn to function with similar fluidity, sensitivity, and creative thinking in similar teaching structures elsewhere. To this end, we foreground and make explicit the mechanisms of film production and reception, the concealed racist and hegemonic metaphors just beneath the surface of the cultural artifact itself, and the hierarchizing institutions of criticism, education, and cultural production which have validated it and have validated the colonial world of the conservatory. This is why we seek to occupy, to vernacularize, or to make indigenous, to build, as the IWW had it, a new society within the shell of the old. Thank you.